Well, I was born precisely on the border of Holland and Belgium. And it was a rather fateful spot, because both the First and the Second World War started there. And so when I was 5 years old, I heard the booming of the Big Bertha guns a few miles away. And looking out of our attic window, I saw the next town, Visay, burning. And I remember a zeppelin coming over. In the meantime, endless processions of miserable refugees with their children. They were the vanguard of all the people who in our century have had to flee their homes with their children on their backs and a few belongings in a baby carriage. And I remember that, I don't remember the words in which I thought. They said, well, these are all human beings brought through our street on pushcarts in bloody bandages. These are all human beings. And so actually my, you could call it obsession with the basic question of what does it mean to be human, was practically born with me. The Chinese sage Hui Neng said, the meaning of life is to see, not to look at ourselves and the world around us, but to see it. Now that became my life's motto, for I became ever more aware of the calamity of having allowed our God-given capacity to see deteriorate into our addiction to merely looking at things, at beings, with all the suffering and all the horror the stupid looking at entails. Any cow and any tiger can look at the world. Only we humans have that gift of seeing. And if we could still see, how could we possibly stand what we look at so unflinchingly on our TV screens? If we could still see the nightmares of Beirut or Sarajevo or Mozambique or whatever the outrage of today, if we could still see those neat rows of corpses, those collapsed buildings, those famished mothers with dead children at their breasts, if we could still see, would we not kneel down or weep or pray or cross ourselves in an attempt to exorcise such depth of evil folly? Drawing for me is the infallible antidote against mere looking at. For drawing is such an immense intensification of perception that the seeing and the drawing can fuse into one single undivided act. And that's an act of total identification with what or whom you are drawing. The drawing, or the painting, is my way of meditation. What does meditation mean? It means to get in touch with what matters. Piano too. If you play something like that, even if you're with the windows closed, because I'm not a good pianist, that's not what I mean. But then you are in touch, as you are in touch when you are drawing a swarm of birds, with the sanity, the sane core of the world and of human beings. And so every day has to have a little while of that. And some people may get that in prayer. But to me, all this is prayer. I'm not putting out ultimations to God or singing his praise. This is something else. This is being in touch with that which matters, or whatever you call it. all this would be quite unthinkable if Glaska were just my wife. Officially, I would say Glaska is my wife, but unofficially, I think we have grown into some kind of single organism, which does not have to discuss, shall we go and sacrifice our backyards? It just happens to come that way. But she's also much more. My name is mentioned as the author of these books, which is a barefaced lie, of course, because without Glaska there wouldn't be any books.
If you see the manuscript, it's so complete changes 5, 6, 7, 8 times. First he writes it by hand, then he writes it by hand again, then I get it, then I can only read it, he can't read it anymore. Then I type it out the first time and I think, oh, it looks pretty good, because I edited it while typing, of course. And then he comes back this way and I try again and I think, no, it's really, it has to go tomorrow, it better be. No, it keeps going forever. So that's a very great part of what I do, you know. And then, of course, the endless correspondence for Pacha. And then, well, so many other things that have to be done, the garden, the birds, my rabbit. It grows all the time, it changes all the time. We're never bored because he has always new ideas constantly, but really constantly.
This place, Peace on Earth, that I built in Warwick, New York, as a kind of oasis of sanity in a very crazy world. As a sign of reverence for life that Schweitzer stood for, a sign of the human, and in short, a sign of hope. I didn't look for a place to start this trans-religious oasis. It came to me, and I saw it as a kind of canvas. I saw it as a possibility to create something, I hope the work of art, but outside of the art game. And at the same time, as a spiritual or religious, if you wish, statement, outside of religious games. There were, however, three contemporaries with whom I had the good fortune to begin some kind of contact. And they are really the ones to whom I dedicated Parchment Terrace. Angelo Roncalli, Pope John XXIII, who by profession was a Catholic, but he was also more than a pope, he was a prophet of human solidarity and a free spirit. Those 4 winters that I drew in Rome, drew the council, were for me really a revelation of the greatness of John XXIII as a human being. Human beings are so much more rare than popes, aren't they? The second great man was Albert Schweitzer, on whose staff Glaska and I worked for 3 years in Africa. I had a patient in New York who drew my attention to that Schweitzer was very much in need of a oral surgery emergency clinic. And I said, ah, I am available, and I left my practice. I was terribly interested to see this phenomenon, this 8th world wonder from close by, and got to know him, and I knew him from very close by because I sat opposite him at table mostly. I got to know him as an extraordinarily human person, not at all the saccharine saint that he was often made out to be, but somebody who could be absolutely mad at people and had a very good sense of humor. When he was 86, at 6 o'clock in the morning, he was studying Bach fugues. I only started 9 o'clock. And he played them much better. Last but not least, Daisai Suzuki, who brought the great wisdom of Zen to the West. And who could answer the quest of what Zen is? Say, it is the great wisdom, it is the great compassion, it is the great compassion, which is the great wisdom. And so this Buddhist sage, this Catholic Pope, and this Protestant doctor and thinker were for me the paradigms of what it means to be human in our time. Actually, I don't call these things sculptures. I call them signs or tokens or icons. I just try to say something with these rather simple means. Some people have said here, is that the hand of God? And said, sure, it's the hand of God. Or somebody says, is that a stigma in that hand, in the second hand? Well, I'll say, yes, indeed it is. And if you ask me, what did I think of too? I thought, that may be an eye in the hand. The hand that sees, it's the hand that draws. So, I mean, these are all free associations. Chief Owen Lyons, who was an important figure in the Native American movement, his quotation from the great law of the Six Nation Iroquois Confederation says, in all our deliberations, we have to be mindful of the impact of our decisions on the seven generation to follow ours. I love to juxtapose those negative spaces of emptiness with whatever came out of them. Now this I call Hiroshima. I also call it the unkillable human. It came about after, in Hiroshima, I saw burned into a concrete wall the shadow of a fellow human who had been evaporated there on August 5th, 1945, the moment the bomb struck. Peace on Earth, it is actually the theme that Parchment Terrace at our place is really devoted to. And we just would like it to make a kind of peaceful noise, you see. This cosmic fish, with all these faces in it, it's an old dream of mine from childhood, really, in which every scale of the fish is a human face. The whole thing together is humanity swimming through the interstellar spaces. To me, the fish is an extremely significant symbol. Stepping stones, and they all have a meaning too. Well, this is one of the oldest of the sculptures. It's actually a gong. And I made it for the play called The Death and Life of Everyone, which is my contemporary variation on the medieval play of Everyman. And I wanted to symbolize this Everyman, who has his black African aspect. And it's Caucasian aspect. But there are the two aspects of the same human everyman. His name is Ouroboros. Ouroboros is the oldest known symbol of eternal life. This snake that bites his own tail and becomes circular. Social mask. And open it up. And you get the true self. True self has been called the indwelling spirit, has been called the Buddha nature. I call it specifically human in us. That's a modern term. Let's put the social mask on again. And be safe. Nicholas of Cusa, who is a Christian mystic from the 15th century, I think, says, in all faces can be seen the face of faces, veiled as in a riddle. So that is this face. This is actually the same theme . There's this mirror in which you can see darkly that same true self, that face of faces, in your own features, the same as the original face. So you just have to go close by. I call this the Kwannon Madonna. The mantle of this Kwannon Madonna, I also call her the Mother of the Earth, is a hollow tree trunk that I found around here. And then there are all those beings, these innumerable beings, embraced in that mantle. And as I say, I also call it the Mother of the Earth. Could call this the eye of God. Could call it the Buddha eye. And what I always love is when you look into it, you see yourself as you are. That means very brief. Very brief. It is a very brief life. You can't grasp it. Just wait and see. Gone. That's the truth. The tree of life. But at the same time, it makes me think of a word of Dionysius. And that is that God is a fountain eternally flowing into itself. And so it's a life fountain. It's a recycled life fountain. I see the fishes, they swim on and on, never reaching the end of the water. I see the birds flying in the sky, flying on and on, never reaching the end of the sky. A painting like the cyclone of birds. I notice now, I don't know if I knew Dogen's sentences when I painted it, but it is that feeling. These paintings are not constructed. Those paintings come out of drawings that I have done at one point and they keep on haunting me until it has to be projected on a canvas. Like the tiny couple in an immense space, I think that's our truth. But it often strikes me that way. Again, each one of that crowd of people is an absolute. Also relative, but also an absolute. And here, this entire mass of people, or line of people, some standing on their heads, some tumbling over on their hands, some in love and leaning against each other. C'est la vie, huh? That's life. That's life as I can't help seeing it. And it's not so different from those birds and those swans. So there's that mystery of the one, the many, and the total. So I wouldn't say that these paintings are philosophical or trying to put over some kind of philosophical concept. There's no concept whatsoever, and that's the difference with much of modern art that is conceptual, whether it's called conceptual or not. This is actually its vision. It is a way of seeing. For me, the question of seeing and looking at is a crucial, absolutely crucial question. When I look at a face and sketch a face, I am sketching a caricature. I choose salient points. He has a bald head, he has a little bit of wool around his chin, and he has two little glasses on. That person I caricature. If I am going to draw that face, I have to see it. It's all there in those few trees. It's all there in a bowl of cherries. And the other day, I painted three little apples, rotten apples, with a lot of insects around it. If I look at that, I say there are three rotten apples with a lot of flies around it. If I start to draw this, I am faced with life, death, and all kinds of variations on the theme. Now, my books, actually, The Zen of Seeing, was based on this question, but it was not as clear yet, because that's 20 years ago almost, this question of seeing versus just looking at. Two books are coming out, but the main book is Zen Seeing, Zen Drawing, Meditation in Action. I call it Postscript to the Zen of Seeing. I'm often asked, but you do those hair fine drawings, and then suddenly you take a piece of steel and you bang it into shape. Why? How? And actually, I don't know. I do know that for me, the drawing, I am in total contact with life as it is. I am not at all a conceptual artist. I don't think things out. They have to come to me or they don't. And sometimes they come in words, then I write. And sometimes they come in the urge to draw, which is always there. And sometimes I have to play it on the piano, and sometimes I make it into a piece of steel. So actually you could say that's a kind of dilettantism. Yes, why not? Why not? Manet said there are no professional artists. There are good artists and there are lousy artists. The function of art is to transmit that preciousness of life, I would say, which is in itself what I would call a spirituality. And if one doesn't dogmatize that, then you can bring people, as it were, together by these means. And so I've been experimenting with these means. And it has worked. Thank you.